All right, welcome to the lecture today. We're very excited to have our guest. He's worn many hats over his very storied career, be it as a musician, band leader, producer, songwriter, composer, and activist. Won't you please welcome Mr. James Mtume.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for being here today.
Thank you for inviting me. I mean, it's really it's a pleasure and an honor to be able to address, you know, the participants. And it's good to see you again.
It's great to see you as well. I mentioned you've worn many hats over your career. I wonder if you, of all those different roles, you know, do you view yourself as any one more so than the others?
No. I don't. That's a great question. If you'd ask me which one did I get the most out of or felt the most joy from, it would be composing for television and film. You know, because it's just, you know, you're alone, you're in the basement, and you got to create the backdrop of a scene. Mm-hmm. And the trick in scoring is to never let the music get in the way of the dialogue, so it becomes more of a wallpaper, or in that case, sound paper. So when I had the opportunity to do a urban show called New York Undercover, to compose for that, it gave me great joy because it was a chance for me to put an urban sound on television. It had never been done like that, right. You know, so.
And you've done film scoring as well,
yes,
for motion
sir.
Pictures.
Yes, sir.
Well, I want to sort of play one track, sort of, not randomly, but picked from, you know, within your career, just to sort of reset our ears and as we settle into this. Some of you may be familiar with this, but from the band, which bears your name.
Which band?
The band that bears your name, Mtume.
I've been in a few.
This one was a favorite of a DJ some of you guys might have heard of named Larry Levan, and it goes like this.
Wow.
Okay, so what was that we just listened to? A little piece of that.
Wow, you took me back with that. I think that was the second Mtume band album. Mm-hmm. And I can't mention that band or that track without giving homage to who I feel is one of the great, great female voices in music. You know, as Tawatha A.G., who was our lead singer. I was part dealing with a transition. I've had several transitions. You know, I started out with avant-garde jazz. If you listen to my first couple of albums, you know, it was all acoustic, avant-garde. And then with my five-year stint with Miles Davis, we were doing, you know, exploratory improvisational funk electronically. So this album was kind of, like the club scene was happening big in New York, you know, and that was like kind of paying a little homage to that, mm-hmm. you know, before I had moved on to like Juicy Fruit and the other stuff. So yeah. That was also probably the last project I did using big arrangements, strings and horns,
right.
You know, because then after that I went into more of a neo-minimalist approach, you know, less was more, maybe using, how do you take 3 or 4 instruments and make them sound like 10?
So you mentioned big orchestrations and bigger arrangements.
Yes, sir.
So what's involved with something like this? I mean, you have the Mtume band,
yes.
Which is how many pieces is the band at this point?
This incarnation,
yeah.
It was, I think, 7 of us.
Okay.
I think it was 7.
So that's already, you know, a decent number.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, you have
what I was doing then, those Mtume, like I said, those first couple of albums, they were done in between all these other projects my partner Reggie Lucas and I were doing. So, you know, I was doing Stephanie Mills, you know, What You Gonna Do, Phyllis Hyman, Lou Rawls, The Spinners, you know. So if we had like 6 weeks, I'd say, okay, let's do an Mtume album. Mm-hmm. And this was my last album like that, because after that I said I would do no more production. It was one day I actually sat down to play. I had a project And tears came to my eyes, and I didn't understand what it was. But this is important for you, a lot of you guys who are writers. I realized what I was playing sounded like everything else I had done. And emotionally, I didn't know how to cope with that. And then it hit me, they talk about writer's, block. I had writer's blockade, you know what I mean? It was like, when everything starts to sound like the last thing you did, it's time to move on or move out. And so that was the last album I did with that musical frame of reference, horns and strings and, much more, like sounding like something else.
Right. And that was a very successful sound for you as a production.
Oh, yeah. That's the reason why we were still doing it. You know, we had about 8 or 9 gold and platinum albums, a Grammy,
Well, let's go back a little ways. You are from a musical family. Where did you grow up, and can you describe, your musical environment coming up?
Yes. I was born and raised in South Philadelphia. My biological father is Jimmy Heath, from the Heath brothers, famous jazz, Percy and Tootie Heath. But the father that raised me was James Hengates Foreman, who was also a very famous, in the Philadelphia area, a pianist. He was a jazz pianist. So at 9 and 10 years old, I'm at the house, quite often. Maybe at dinner, there's Dizzy Gillespie, there's Thelonious Monk, there's John Coltrane. Now, I'm not going to sit here and lie to y'all like, I knew how deep that was. I don't even do shit, I'm 9, you know what I mean? But I did know there was something very, very special. And Lalo Schifrin would come by a lot. Sonny Stitt would stay at the house when he was working in Philly. So I had a chance to be around that. And I always say my front ground is jazz. It's not background, it's front ground. Yeah. And out of that, I moved into other forms and variations in music. But I grew up, in jazz. Like I was going to the clubs at 14, putting a little mascara, But I couldn't get no drinks, but I was sneaking in. I mean, this is true talk. This is Red Bull, right? But I also grew up with R&B. So as we talked before, I'm listening to Marvin Gaye, and maybe that weekend I'm going to hear Yusef Lateef, at Pep's, and I grew up with both. The first time I realized my musical tastes were a little different than the rest of the kids, I remember it was in sixth grade, and everybody had to bring 2 records. I brought Frankie Lyman, Why Do Fools Fall in Love, and then I brought Miles Davis. The kids, everybody was really getting off with Frankie Lyman. But when they put Miles on, it was like Dr. Death had come in the room, And then it was that I realized jazz was an acquired taste. Mm-hmm. And that I was very fortunate to have been born in that environment. Mm-hmm. It's almost like having both worlds to draw from. Right.
So when did you start playing yourself?
Well, like I said, my dad, Ken Gates, was a jazz pianist. Now remember, at that time, McCoy Tyner was coming around the house, right, taking lessons from my old man, and Lee Morgan. Wow. I remember Lee Morgan very well. So the piano was always there. So, I just naturally started playing, and I found out I could basically play with anything I heard. Yeah. Not anything, of course. I mean, I wasn't dealing with Beethoven, but, basically I could figure out chords. Right. So I had an ear, and I just started playing around the house. And my mother was also a big inspiration. She was, she was very much into all the jazz singers, Lady Day, and she could actually sing very well. And my Dinah Washington was my sister's godmother, and we would go like on a couple of weeks each summer, stay up at her crib. So there was always music around. So that's, I started playing like that, And then my uncle Kumba Tootie Heath bought me a kunga, and that opened me up for the percussion. So the piano, playing the piano, and also playing percussion, harmony and rhythm was the same thing to me.
Yeah, so they're actually quite similar in a
lot
of ways.
Yes, the piano is a percussive instrument. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now, you left Philadelphia not to pursue music, though.
No.
So what were you doing?
I had this horrible revelation my father induced me to. When I was growing up, I just knew the greatest basketball player back then was a guy named Elgin Baylor. He was the forerunner to, Miles and MJ and Dr. J. But I just knew I was going, there was no way I wasn't going to get a basketball scholarship. And then one day he came and I was down in the basement in my sanctuary practicing. And he said, you know, man, you ain't going to be tall. And it was like, oh, shit. You know what I mean? So you're going to have to figure out how you're going to go to college. So I was a swimmer, actually. I got to college on a swimming scholarship. You know, as of now, there's not many black swimmers. So imagine what that was back then. You're talking about, you know, early 60s. You know, I had those experiences of going to a swimming meet and watching all the, when I walked in, all the umpires run into a corner to decide if I could get in the water. I was at one, I remember a meet that some guys were throwing matches fire on me. So, you know, you develop a backbone. So I had a political consciousness. And plus, you know, my parents were very much involved in the civil rights movement. So I ended up going to California on a swimming scholarship and ended up dealing with, you know, black activism during the 60s.
Right. So where did you wind up going to school?
Pasadena City College.
Okay. So near Los Angeles. Now, what was going on in Los Angeles as far as activism at that time?
Well, if you remember, I went out in 66, summer of 66. So anybody trying to figure it out, I'm 67. So some of this stuff goes way back before a lot of y'all were even thought about. And the Watts Revolt had happened. But you have to understand, in the country at that time, it was activism all across the board. You had the young white students who were dealing with the war. You had the Black Panthers. I was with an organization called Us Organization that was a cultural organization. We created something called Kwanzaa that's still celebrated today. But the country, there was a different temperature in the country. And activism was kind of, and we were all pretty much coming out of a college movement. So obviously I migrated to that. And that's, you know, and then one thing fell apart, the organization fell apart. And then I was asked to come back to Newark, New Jersey by a gentleman named, a dear friend of mine who just passed, Imam Mubaraka. And he asked me to come back to help on the Ken Gibson campaign, which was the first black mayor elected on the East Coast. So I came back for that. And then I met this guy named Miles Davis and the rest was, you know, it was over. It was about the music.
Right. Yeah, but you did get into the music and work on the music previous to joining Miles.
Oh, yes.
As well.
Yes.
Just to give people an idea where your music was at that point, and you were still playing piano or playing percussion at that point?
Yeah, both. I always played both.
Let's hear a little something from an album that you worked on. Okay, so that's kind of a family project, correct?
Yes.
All right.
That was Herbie Hancock on piano, my uncle Tootie Kumba on drums, Buster Williams on bass, Don Cherry was on trumpet, and Jimmy Heath was on sax. Mm-hmm. That song was called Camille. I wrote that for my wife. That was my uncle's album, but he called me, and you know, he knew I had been writing, and he's, you know, he gave me my first shot.
Yeah.
You know, it almost tears me up to think that he had that much faith. He said, I want you to write all the music.
Right. Yeah.
I said, but it's not my album. He said, yeah, but it's going to be your music. And that's the way it kicked off, being in there, showing Herbie Hancock, here's the chords, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, you know, but that was a great experience.
Yeah.
Now, when did you become known professionally, well, I guess beyond professionally, as Mtume?
I purposely never wanted the connection with the Heath name. Not because though I had a problem with my bloodline. Mm-hmm. It was that I always had this thing about siblings or children who were born of parents, or one of the parents is famous in one field or another. And I never wanted to feel like, I didn't want to walk in anybody's shoes. I wanted my own sandals. So I usually kept that out, or even when I signed with Epic, they were like, this is a great, you know, for the PR. I said, no. I want people to know me for what I accomplished. Then they can make the connection. But I would say it started getting known when I went back to New York. And this is a really interesting story. I don't think I've ever said this publicly. Every young musician fantasizes about who they wanted to play with. And it's an honest truth. I had three names I wanted to play with, and it was in this order. First was McCoy Tyner. Second was Freddie Hubbard. Third was Miles Davis, none of whom I'd even met. I get to New York. 2 weeks as I'm in New York, I get a call. McCoy Tyner was getting ready to record next week, and he wanted to know if you can do the album. Number one, that was number one on the list. Number two, Freddie Hubbard calls. I work with him. And while I was working with Freddie Hubbard at a place called the Vanguard in New York, Miles Davis came to hear me. I didn't see him, but he sat in the corner and everybody told me he was there. And 2 weeks after that, I got a call, you know, Miles Davis. He said, man, what you doing for the next 9 months? He said, we're going to go to Europe. And I said, I'm down. Wow. And that's, so I guess it was around that time.
Yeah. And with Herbie Hancock, this is kind of as a side note, out of curiosity. He had the Mwandishi group.
Yes.
Now, was it true that you gave the names to all the players in that group?
Yeah. Herbie and the group were very interested in culture in Swahili. So, you know, every time they came to town, I would go hear them. And then one day, they just gave them the names. They wanted names to translate for the group. And Mwandishi was his name. It means the writer.
And all the other players.
And all the other players,
took had all the names as well. Okay, so back to Miles. So Miles has come join me in the group. What was your first impression of Miles?
Shit, I mean, Miles and I had a very, 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 very close relationship. As a matter of fact, in his autobiography, he talks about how he loved me like a son. And we would talk because we're both insomniacs. You know, I don't go to sleep till 3-4 in the morning, even now, you know. And we would talk music. Mm-hmm. And we would talk about concepts. I would call that my introduction to Zen. You know, learning what you don't play sometimes is more important than what you play. Sometimes leave something out. Don't finish a statement, you know. Like I said, you know, there's no such thing as a mistake if you learn something, okay? And these lessons, you know, silence is sound because it's air, you know what I mean? And you learn that and you apply that to understanding melody. You begin to understand, okay, out of these 10 notes I could use, what's the two that implies the other eight? It's the appreciation for abbreviation. Most people musically, they talk in paragraphs. Learn how to talk in quotations. Take your music and reduce it to its highest goal. You know, it's like people who talk too much, you know. You know what I mean? It's just too many notes. You know, why? At a certain point, I can't digest all that anyway. So what's the ones that really matter? Especially your songwriters. The secret to songs is melody. Everything else is under that, but at the end of the day, that's the tip of your iceberg. Mm-hmm. You got too many notes. If I can't hum your song, it ain't a hit. Everything is a nursery rhyme at the end of the day, mm-hmm. but you got to make it your nursery rhyme. Mm-hmm.
How would you describe the music you guys were making in the Miles Davis group at that time?
Improvisational funk. Using electronics in a way that it had never been used. And I'm talking about, I joined the band in 71. We recorded an album in 72 that really set the stage for a whole new musical movement. But the critics, who were too arrogant to ask what we were doing, decided to write about something they didn't even know. They didn't even have a vocabulary. I always say it's like inviting Kool-Aid drinkers to a wine tasting contest. They didn't even have the palate. But they were writing about it. I just appreciate YouTube. You know, my son and I were talking about this on the way over. That's my son, Fire, and my granddaughter, Aya, right here. She's 11. She's also our security guard. But But taking this very complex musical idea and pushing the music, pressing the boundaries, to me, that's always what it was about, pressing the boundaries. That's one of the things I find, I'm not going to say boring about a lot of contemporary music, but certainly repetitious. Right. People are scared to take chances. You don't move music by standing still. You got to move music by believing in what you're doing and not being afraid of criticism. Mm-hmm. You know, and trying something. You know, there's an old African proverb that says, to stumble is not to fall. It's really just to move forward faster. Right. Some of y'all will get that later, but you understand? You know, you don't really fall. You stumble, but that's pushing it. It's not enough push. That's why I'm so happy to see what you guys are doing here. This is very important. You have an opportunity to really hone your craft and share it with other people who are on the same creative level. That's very important.
Let's take a look at you and Miles Davis and some of the rest of the band in Tokyo. So you used to come to Japan every year.
Yes. I think the first trip I came to Japan was with Miles, I think in 72, no later than 73. And then I'd been back and forth several times, Sonny Rollins, Roberta Flack, my own band, you know. But that, man, just to see that, that's a lot of memories, man.
What's the most Miles Davis thing that you recall about Miles Davis and working within that? Either from maybe just what were rehearsals like? I mean, you know.
No rehearsals. No. And there was a reason. Mm-hmm. And the reason I responded like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like one of the young guns. And I'm one of them guys, man, we got to rehearse. Mm-hmm. So he pulled me to the side. I mean, when I say no rehearsals, I think maybe during that entire 5 years, maybe we rehearsed three times.
Three times?
Yeah, maybe.
Okay.
Miles pulled me to the side and said, look, I mean, he used much harsher language, but, you know, it was in a very fatherly way. He said, look, he said, man, I pay you to rehearse on stage. It took me a minute to understand that. He said, I don't want to cook this. I don't want to ever overcook the meal. And I had to think about that, and then I understood what he was saying. Every night, I want this to be an adventure. He said, because if you start rehearsing this, now for what we were doing, because every night, you know, you don't know where you're going. So your musical antenna always had to be really sharp. But he wanted an adventure every night.
Yeah.
So you start rehearsing, you start finding yourself playing certain patterns that you know work. Okay. It's like a singer who can sing high notes. Okay, I'm gonna get them right here. Ah, and everybody goes, ah, you know. Yeah. You don't want preconditioned thoughts in your head.
Was that the same with the recording process as well?
Yeah. Yeah. You never knew when you were gonna record. He didn't like to let you know. You get a call the day before the recording. Sometimes I remember we came in one session and he had some music written out and then he had it in colors, you know, B flat minus seven, and that's in blue, and, you know, C sharp something, and that's in yellow and orange. So we, you know, it was like, you know, you with somebody who's really there, you know? So you don't really want to feel square and ask. You know what I mean? Like, if I'm here, then he obviously thinks we're hip enough. So we kind of figured those colors represented feelings. So what is blue to you? That would determine the inversion of the chord. Or rhythmically, how would you interpret red?
Right.
And that's, I mean, like I said, Zen stuff, man. I'll tell you one experience. That was one of the most overwhelming experiences I ever had. We were playing in Lebanon, and It was during the time of the Israeli and the Lebanese were having physical struggles. I mean, it was war. And when we played, the president's son came to hear us. So we're surrounded by about 100, 200 soldiers, machine guns and everything, because, you know. And you know that took the music somewhere. So after we finished, we're in the dressing room. It was like a tent. And all of a sudden, we hear this, you know, and all these guns cocking. And it's, I'm like, what? We're going to get it here like this? And this guy runs through, this Arab cat runs through. He breaks through, and he falls at Miles' feet. Miles is sitting in a chair, and he starts crying. And this is the honest truth. He says, now I can die. And like, we look like, he said, man, I never thought I'd live to see you. He said, your music saved my life. I was going through some difficult periods, and your music, and you know, we all trying to be hard, but everybody started getting that little water, you know? And then I looked at Miles and he teared up, but it was showing me that you never know who your music's touching, and you never know the effect you're having on people. Mm-hmm. Just hear somebody fall at somebody's feet and say that, it made me respect what we were doing and what all musicians do even more. Because it was a direct connection with how music affects people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, I don't mean to get that, but you know that's, you know, it was an overwhelming experience.
I can imagine.
Now there was also a lot of, not just running through a take from start to finish with Miles. It was editing. Is that something that you were aware was going on at the time when you're there? I mean, sort of like taking all these different pieces and just putting them together to make it something new.
I was aware, but I was not aware to the extent that that was being done by the producer, Teo Macero, right. who was himself a great saxophone player. Then I found out that they were doing things like, back then, we're talking about 72, 73, Miles would take T.O. some cassette tapes, and that would be edited into some of those songs. If you're listening to On the Corner, some of those are a combination of four takes, and you never hear any difference. It's seamless. It's a seamless transition. But he was a genius in taking things and migrating them into other things. Just a piece, pieces here and there.
I just want to play a little piece of something just because it's so different from the stuff that came immediately after from the Miles Davis group. Just a little piece of this.
Now,
you're laughing a little bit while we're playing this, and what's going through your mind?
Man, I'm flashing. I mean,
we didn't even get to the crazy part.
First of all, there were so many things that we were mixing into that, to that broth. You know, I guess Miles had bitches brew, we were the broth. Mm-hmm. We were all big fans of P-Funk, and, you know, James. Also, Stockhausen, Cage, Stravinsky, and that's Miles playing, you know, those chords. You know,
There's no trumpet on this track.
No trumpet. Matter of fact, we talked about that, and he said he just got into the rhythm, man. And we were just all hitting it. He said it really was no room for the trumpet, and that was another thing about Miles. He never forced anything. Now what? Lead horn player, do you know, wouldn't play on the track? Yeah, we you know, so it was always about surrender to what the music required. Mm-hmm. So a lot of that, like I said, is funk, but you've got all this dissonance, and that's a lot of that is Stockhausen, mm-hmm. that influence.
Now, in the band with Miles is a guitarist,
yeah,
by the name of Reggie Lucas,
right? My partner when we started out, yeah.
So, what happened? How did the Miles band come to an end, and what did that lead to?
Well, as most things, like marriage, it came to an end, you know. Which story you want to pick? It's like, we were on tour with Herbie Hancock, who had his big record, Headhunters, right, thank you. And Miles got sick, and we only did like two concerts, two shows together. And so at that time, nobody was clear about when he was going to come back. And it ended up being, 5 years? You know? Mm-hmm. So I think we all made the right decision, you know? And so Reggie and I had been experimenting with writing. Pete Cozy was the other guitarist. Mm-hmm. And Michael Henderson pursued a huge success in R&B. Al Foster was the drummer. Dave Liebman was a sax player, extraordinary saxophonist. So we started writing, and I joined Roberta Flack. Roberta had been calling. She was a big fan of Miles's, and she was, you know, also appreciated my playing very much. So I was confronted with two offers, and I had to make a decision. It was Weather Report and Roberta. Wow. So I said, well, Weather Report came from what I came from. I said, I want to do something different. So I decided to go with Roberta. And it was the best decision. So while I'm with Roberta Flack, she called me and said she needed a guitarist. At that time, Reggie was living in Chicago. I told him, I said, I know one. So Reggie came and joined. So to make a long story short, we're in the middle of recording this album called Blue Lights in the Basement. And we took a dinner break. I was kind of bored anyway. And so everybody left to go to dinner. So I had been messing around with this melody. So I told Reggie to stay, and I sat down at the piano. So it was like, dee 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 doo dee 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 doo dee. It was something called The Closer I Get to You. So when everybody came back, I gave them their parts, and I just wanted to put it on the tape. So we're listening back. Roberta comes back. She says, what's that? I said, The Closer I Get to You. It was no such song. I just felt a moment, you know what I mean? She said, can I record it? Sure. She said, you got the lyrics? I said, oh no, I left them at home. That's beautiful. I just did the thing. But you know, when you feel, hey man, this might be a shot. Yeah. So we recorded it. I told her I could get the lyrics back to her, you know, in the morning. Yeah. So I wrote the lyrics in the back of the car on the way back to the house. Obviously, I wasn't driving.
That would have been even more impressive. Yeah.
I got it to her, and I suggested that she do it, a duet with Donny Hathaway. They hadn't done anything in a long time. And that record came out. We did about 5 million units. So That's when my writing career started in pop music.
Okay, and it sounded a little like this. Okay, so I want to know, at any point did somebody say to you, okay, I just heard you, you know, doing this other stuff. It's a little bit different. How did you get to doing this? I mean, what prepared you to be able to do this? Because it is so drastically different from what you were doing immediately before, or more or less immediately before, professionally.
Yeah. I've always been of the persuasion that art is like water, and it takes the shape of whatever you pour it into. You know, musically, I don't have any boundaries of what I pour it into. Mm-hmm. You know, when I'm doing avant-garde acoustic music, I'm there, you know what I mean? Yeah. And it's also about the ability to be open to transition. I've always felt that most artists get locked into, you know, the quicksand of sameness. You understand? You're just doing the same thing, and you're not following. I've always followed what my ear was telling me. You know, I never lied to the music, and the music never lied to me. And you just have to be open. I guess that's the best way to explain. It's interesting. Nobody's ever asked me that quite like that, but that's the truth. It's just, This is where I'm at now. Yeah. You know, and I never go back. I pretty much try to burn the bridges, so I don't even have an opportunity to go back where I came from. So if I cross that bridge, I burn it. Never give yourself a chance to look back, because that's always easier. Looking forward is always harder. So that's a great question. I hope that answer is you know, sufficient.
So you and Reggie.
But it is drastic. Yeah.
It's drastic. Well, it's, you know, it's more drastic because of how we.
Yeah. But you're right. It's drastic.
But I mean, you and Reggie become a production songwriting team, and what was the sound that you guys were going for together?
Well, what had happened when we first hooked up? We started actually messing around writing when I was with Miles. Mm-hmm. I was doing more lyrics and melody. Reggie was doing the music. When Reggie moved to Chicago, that's when I said, okay, the closer is the first example. This is where I want to take it. So I'm doing, you know, constructing where we're going, you know, with the actual sound. And what I wanted to do was develop a sound. Again, I come from the belief, knowing who you are and having your own signature is the most important thing to do as an artist. Sounding like somebody is you should be slapped in your face, okay? You know, there's the three stages I could talk about, the creative sequence. The first stage is imitation. I don't care who you are, where you come from. I don't care if you're artist, poet, I mean musician, poet, you know, painter, sculptor. There's somebody that you see and you say, damn, I want to do it just like that. So you pretty much imitate. That's your first guide. Then somewhere along there, you develop what I call a passage to emulation. Now, what do I mean by that? You still have that other person, you know, that is your main influence, but you're starting to find a little bit of yourself. And if you're fortunate enough, you go to the third stage, innovation. That's when you establish who you are. And that's a result of all those things that go through your funnel. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to find it, put a rhythm section together that was, you know, created for the specific purposes of going after a sound.
What's the key to maintaining a good partnership musically, you know, with somebody creative?
Success. You know, it's an old saying, success needs no explanation, failure can never be explained. You know, you don't stay with something but so long if it's a failure. Right. So if you're rolling, you stay with it as long as, you know, it's feeding you. And I don't just mean economically, I mean it's feeding you. And all partnerships usually end with you're no longer nourished by what the music that you're producing. Mm-hmm. So you got to go out and go to the next level.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's just hear a little something.
We didn't have a fallout, you know. We had a grow out, you know. Sometimes you dig.
This is another thing from that era with you and Reggie Lucas. What's your strategy with dealing with vocalists? Do you have a go-to sort of philosophy that you adhere to that works, or is it a case-by-case basis? That's Stephanie Mills, by the way. I didn't say who it was. What you gonna do?
Well, I think one of the keys that you need to establish is what kind of voice you pull to it. Which one are you drawing? I've always been closer to the female voice. Mm-hmm. I feel that. An important thing to understand with a vocalist, don't overproduce the vocalist. Be a guide, because a lot of times a singer can get stuck. They don't know where to go. Be there for that. But you really got to know what you're doing, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If you're guiding somebody. But don't get in the way of an artist. Because when an artist is free to do what they do best, that's when you get the best performance. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're trying to every line. No, the thing is, all right, here's the line. And sometimes you have to adjust. Maybe the melody you had in your head doesn't work with that artist. Right. You heard it perfectly when you're doing it, but you're not the recording artist. So if they fit, at the end of the day, to answer your question, what you go for, what feels right. Because sometimes what you wrote is not going to work when you record it. I can't tell you how many songs I thought were great. You know, and then the next day you record it, you say, what, am I kidding? You know? But don't get in the way of your artists. Be there to shape and direct where they're going. You know, a lot of times people, you know, they're frustrated artists themselves. So, you know, sing it like this. Well, no, it don't work like that. Let them be free. Let them be free.
What are your recollections of working with Donny Hathaway and Phyllis Hyman? Two supremely talented, but obviously tortured artists.
It's very interesting you bring that up because, as a matter of fact, as soon as I get back to New York, there's a cat from Holland who's doing a documentary on Donny. And he's in New York right now, and I'm going to, you know, put my part on it. That's very heavy for me because the last two songs Donny Hathaway ever sang were two songs that I did, The Closer and another song called Back Together Again, as a matter of fact. That's the night he died. It's a little, you know, I know he killed himself that night, you know. We recorded the song, and it was a Saturday night, and he had a breakdown in the studio. And as a result, he couldn't continue. So I says, cool, Donnie, don't worry. We'll finish it Monday. And about 5 o'clock in the morning, which would have been Sunday morning, my phone is ringing. Now, you know, when it's early like that, you know, that's weird, you know, because I picked it up. And it was someone crying. And I said, who's this? And she said, it's Roberta. She said, him too, man. And Donnie's dead. So it's strange every time I hear Back Together Again because I'm both proud that he's such a great artist and that you had the opportunity for him to do a couple of your songs. But, you know, Donnie was troubled, as was Phyllis Hyman. Donnie didn't leave a note. Phyllis did leave a note. And a dear friend of mine, Kenny Gamble, Gamble and Huff, he called me and when he had the note, and he read it to me. And she was really troubled with new artists coming along. And she felt, I mean, if you can imagine this, she felt she was too old to, and I'm like, one of the greatest voices ever. But, you know, people have their own insecurities. And, you know, she ultimately took her life while she was in the middle of a week of performances at the Apollo Theater with the Whispers.
Do you have other recollections of working with Phyllis, though? What kind of stands out?
First of all, the voices. I always say everything is about the voice. Phyllis had one of the most interesting tones for a female. She had a low register that just ran through you. And I enjoyed it because she, you know, she cussed like I did. She was a sailor, you know. F you. I said, yeah, F you do. And there's a section on one of the songs, You Know How to Love Me, where she sings this long note, and I had to do it over and over till it was right. So right after that, she said, F you. I said, okay, cool. So she strolls out. I said, let's take a dinner break. So while she goes out, I have one of the cats go out and get a dozen roses, tie them around the microphone. She comes back. I said, okay, we ready? She said, yeah. She walks out. I had the lights out in the recording where my microphone was. I put the lights on. She's standing in front of roses. And she broke down crying. I mean, that's the kind of sensitivity it was, you know. And I just loved her. I loved her, man. Phyllis was great.
Yeah. Is it tough to resolve these kind of conflicts in the studio? I mean, everybody here is working together and in close proximity.
I've never had thou speakest too soon. I had one bad experience, you know. The studio is where you don't, you check your ego at the door. Mm-hmm. That means for the producers and the artists. And I had one bad, I'm not even going to mention their name because, you know, it'll probably make me mad again. But he was a drag, but okay. Just one.
All right. So that was the only unresolvable situation. Right. But
I quit.
Okay. But everything, hopefully everything is resolvable at some point.
That's the happiest place in the world to be. In the studio. The one thing I never work, if I'm working in the studio, I never allow guests. the artist guest or my personal guest. Anybody, they have to wait outside. Because if an artist is singing, she's looking, you know, from that room, look into the control room, and if you got these people singing, it turns into a performance. You see, you can't help it. If I'm singing, it's a performance because we've made a connection. So you take that out, and everything is here. It's like being under a microscope. Mm-hmm. And I've always felt you get the best performance when there's no audience. We're just in there, just me and the engineer. And that's how I've always worked. Okay. So everybody has their own way.
Right. So then you mentioned a little bit earlier how Mtume, the band, formed. Can you, you know, as a sort of a thing when the other sessions weren't happening, what did you envision for the band Mtume that was different from what you were doing on these productions?
Well, like I said, the first two albums were just, hey, let's do an album. You know, we had this deal. I had to fill it. I had to deliver an album. I didn't take the band serious until as I talked earlier, when I had that moment I had to confront, I was doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I decided I wouldn't produce anybody else. I didn't produce anybody. I said, I'm going to take a year, put another band together, find a studio. Because the studio is the other musician. The studio is a sound. You know, mm-hmm. and an engineer, and I took off a year. I only worked in one room in New Jersey, a place called Ears, and that was the Juicy Fruit album. And I didn't do anything else. And that's when I found out what my vision was for the band. Mm-hmm. I didn't have a vision. I had just a reason to fill a contract. Right. But on that album, I said, no, we're going to do this, and I'm going to do it. I didn't think, like, I'm going to change the direction. But I said, I want to do something where it's a new sound. Yeah. And again, like you said, not radical, but it was definitely a departure from everything else that was out there.
Right.
So I take the record to Epic. They're into, we can't put this out. I'm like, why? They said, it's too slow. Because they were dealing with beats per minute. I don't know who came up with that madness. Yeah, I mean, beats per minute. It's like, I said, man, I write from my heart, not from my head. And they said, well, it's too slow, but the other thing, you know, it's risque. Now, you got to take yourself back. This is 1983. That's like a virgin now. I mean, you know, but with some of the stuff that's on records now, you know. But at that time, they didn't want to put it out. So this is what they did. This was their negotiation with me. We put it out since you were insisting, but we're not going to release it for daytime play. So it was only initially released for night after 12 o'clock formats. After 1 week, they were getting so many calls, you know, from around the country. They said, and the report they kept getting was, is probably the first record that anybody remembered where you knew the song by the beat. Before any, as soon as you hear it, so obviously they did finally have to acquiesce, you know, to getting that money. You know, that's what, it wasn't like they loved it, they hated it, but, you know, money heals all things. And, so, you know, obviously I became one of their favorite, you know, but that was that story. So when I hear that line, oh, also I got sued, I forgot, by Juicy Fruit Gum, Wrigley's.
Right, so what happened
so
there?
This is, keep this right here, don't let that out of the room. So I get called in, I have to take a deposition, right? So I roll in, I forgot, some big, huge, humongous law firm in New York, and I go in. So I'm this black guy, I walk in, I mean, it's one of the longest tables I'd ever seen, with all these elderly white guys sitting around, and I'm taking a deposition. So it finally gets down to, you know, I knew ultimately it's gonna come to this. Well, Mr. Mtume, what do you mean by you can lick me everywhere? So I knew I had him then, you know. So I rolled back. Well, I said, obviously it's not about gum. I said, it's about oral sex. And you should have seen the looks that came. I don't think anybody in that room was under 70. You know what I mean? It was just, but that's the great story I have. I don't think I've ever told it publicly. Yeah. What do you mean by you can? I mean, what kind of question is that? First of all. So that's why I laughed, y'all. But go ahead.
So how did the beat come to being then?
What happened? You know, as I said earlier, you know, I was working. We were just dedicated to this album. So we had finished one of the sessions, and it was about 2 a.m. Everybody left, but I had this thing in my head. So I sat down, and the Linn drum had kind of just came out, and it wasn't really being used that much in R&B. So I just sat down, and I said, doom, ticka doom, kick goom, gack, doom, ticka doom, kick goom, goom, gack. And I said, that feels interesting. So I laid it. I didn't quantize it. That's why it's slightly off. So it has more of a human thing to it. Because sometimes when you quantize, to me, something being exact is not cool. Because the humanity is sucked out. So I recorded like that. I called everybody back to the studio. So the guys get back at about 3 a.m. We laid the track. Tuatha was on tour with Roxy Music. She was in Europe. She had 2 days off, flew her back. We recorded. I'm writing the lyrics as she's recording them, and got her back on a plane, so she could, you know, meet Roxy Music and finish, and you know, that's how that went.
So how did you take to drum machine hardware as a percussionist yourself? You know, I guess this is what's even more interesting as a record for you personally is, okay, the drum machine is the thing that's pushing this record through. And is that, counterintuitive for you as a musician because you're used to doing it yourself with your own hands?
No, not at all. Again, you know, be like water. That was the shape that I was pouring it in. You know, I'm not threatened by technology. I welcome it. I digest it. You know, but I also try to humanize it. You know, when you just depend on technology, but you have no musical understanding, you know, that's the first thing you lean on. It's making everything perfect. You know, it's like, I can do this all day. The trick is, do I know how to do that? To make it lean, to curve the thing. You know, it's like, it's a combination of intuition, intellect, and technique. You got to know what those things are, you know. But if you're just sitting at a machine and don't know those other intricacies of what it is to deal with music or any art form, you know. So yeah, no, I'm not threatened by technology. If that was the case, I wouldn't use lights.
Well, that was always the counter argument to, you know, the radical Miles Davis music as well, right? Because the critics were like, why are you playing this dissonant electric music? Mm-hmm. Why isn't Miles playing acoustic music?
Because that's where he was. And that bridge was already burned. You see, sometimes people are really offended when you move on. It's like a relationship. How dare you? You know, you moved on. But if you don't follow your instinct and your intuition, then you never know what the joy, you'll never experience the joy of really being creative. Because you'll be stuck in that quicksand, scared to do something different. And the least of all, I don't care what anybody thinks. If I think it's cool, try it.
Right.
That doesn't mean you don't listen to other opinions. I mean, then that's arrogance. But I mean, like I said, too much now, it's like, if I can die just for a second, mm-hmm. Branding, you know, people don't talk about the music somebody's creating. They talk about their brand. And somebody suffers when that happens. And who suffers more often than not is the listener and the fan. Because you're going to get the same bullshit in a different cup, in a different package. Oh, but because that's so-and-so, it must be good. What? No. Is it good based on the fact that it's good? Mm-hmm. So you see a lot of stuff, people put out the same album 12 times over, and everybody's, oh, the new so-and-so. Oh, it's great. Why? You're scared to have an opinion because some of this stuff is really bad. Some of it's really great, but your branding And like in boxing, it's happened to me. I see this. You know, look, right after music, boxing is just my second favorite thing in the world. Mm-hmm. But I see fighters who don't fight to defend the title. They fight to protect it. So your brand. So you don't fight Pacquiao, okay? But then the whole boxing game gets turned because it's about the best meeting the best. And in the music, that's starting to happen. Branding. That's why you only have two or three major stars. When did that happen? Right. I knew 50 great female singers, 50 great saxophonists. Right. But what is this thing we got? One or two of this, one or two of that. Mm-hmm. When did that happen? Branding is a dangerous thing because it puts brakes on the creative process. Because you know you can sell by just putting it out because your name. No, you have to earn the right for people to love your music.
You mentioned at the top of the conversation that scoring was one of your passions. And at this point in your career, the technology and the scoring came together a little bit and it sounded a little like this, right? Now, what's that from?
That's from the film Native Son. It's called Bigger's Beat. It was a scene as he's walking down, you know, the street, you know, in the ghetto. It's like back in the late 30s. So it was just that.
It's a period piece, yeah, and yet you have this, you know.
Yeah.
This proto.
Music is timeless. I hate the idea when a film takes place in one period and the composer feels like he's got to compose music from that period. I find it much more interesting when you mix periods, you know, because music translates into any time.
How did you find this experience of doing the score for that film?
Fun, big fun, big fun. Just being alone by myself, you know. I think on that one, I was using the Fairlight had just come out.
Right.
And like I said, as I moved on to do a television series, I had everything set up in my basement because technology was accessible like that. Mm-hmm.
Now, the funny thing is, I mean, a lot of us know this from a different source, not necessarily the soundtrack to the film. I only knew this, and I think maybe some others, as a record that Kid Capri used to spin back and forth at the beginning of tapes and stuff like that. And it was like, oh, okay, what's this?
You know what's such, that's a very interesting point. One of the first rapper that came to me was Grandmaster Flash. You know, we knew each other. Mm-hmm. And he came to me about that track, and he told me something that I never forgot. He said, Mtume, he said, we sample your stuff. He said, because your music is holy. He said, no, I don't mean like religious holy. He said, it's got a lot of holes in it. And what he meant was what I was talking about earlier, space. You know, he said, it's a lot of things we can take. Like, you know, after Biggie did Juicy, that like opened that up for a whole new generation who had never heard the original. You know, so then you have the sample of the sample being sampled and sampled. I call it Sample Simon, but anyway. But Yeah, they for some reason, the cats
took to this one.
Cats took to that.
Now, obviously, Juicy has been sampled. Sampling became something that emerged as a very important part of hip hop in the mid and late 80s. Yes. And you became a part of the conversation about the ethics of sampling. What was your stance at the time, and how did you get pulled into that conversation?
Okay, and I'm glad you brought that up, because I can clear that up right on Red Bull. It was a misconception. What happened was, I was doing a radio show, and it was called Year in Review on Kiss FM in New York. And we were talking about the events that happened, you know, it's like the week before New Year's Day or something. So I said, the most turnabout thing that I heard, I was driving in the car, and this has only happened to me a few times in my life, that something came on the radio and I had to pull over to the side. And it was a song called Bring the Noise. I had to hear, who is this? And it was like Thelonious Monk. How can these guys be playing in all these different keys? Yeah. I'm thinking somebody's playing. Because, you know, again, I wasn't familiar, as most in my generation, with sampling. So on this radio show, I mentioned the deepest musical thing I'd heard was this group, Public Enemy, in this song, Bring the Noise. Then the subject came up about sampling. And I said, excuse me, my problem with sampling was you can't take somebody's music and just rap on it and call it your song. No more than I could take a rapper's rap off and call it my song. In other words, pay the people who are providing the music. If you're not creating the music, somebody is. I mean, if James Brown got a penny for all the times he was sampled, he would have never had to perform again. He never got paid. So that was my point with sampling. You must pay if you're going to use somebody's music. Why should they not get paid? So Daddy-O from Stetsasonic, and we're great friends after this, but we was going at it. He put out this record called Talking All That Jazz. That's about me. I'm going to knock you out, you know. And he completely misunderstood what I was saying. First of all, I said Public Enemy, and Hank Shockley, and the Bomb Squad. That was some of the most creative stuff I'd ever heard. But as things happened, you know, we both macho. It got macho, so I felt myself out on a limb because nobody from my generation was saying nothing. And like I tell people, I don't mind being out on a limb. I'm just scared of sauce. You know what I mean? So I defended it, but it got a little out of hand, but I was never against sampling. First of all, how hypocritical could that be of me? I mean, as much as Juicy and stuff like that has been sampled, but I was saying at that time they were not paying the artists that they were that they were sampling, mm-hmm. and I didn't think it was right.
Mm-hmm. And yeah,
does that clear that up?
Yeah, you became sort of known as the anti-sampling guy.
Right, and that's not true at all. It became that because nobody else was speaking up. Yeah. See, there was a great divide that happened, you know, in the black community generationally when hip hop was coming into full bloom. And it was a divide between the older generation and the younger. I've always sided with the younger because I felt my generation didn't leave a proper blueprint and they were not supportive, you know. But sampling became almost this lightning rod. But that's never, and I became the target. But like I said, I'm a big boy. You know, my skin ain't thin. But my point was, you must pay the people whose music you're sampling.
Right. And things had changed by the time Juicy had come out
right,
then, too.
Right.
So what was your impression of Juicy when you heard it?
Oh, I loved it. I loved it. First of all, I was honored that the next generation or an artist from the next generation, because it's about the music first and foremost. Had it sold or not, I was just like, wow, they felt that. You know, they felt that good about it. I remember when I met Biggie. I was doing New York Undercover at the time, and I was up in Uptown having a meeting with Andre Harrell. And Andre said, oh, Puffy, while you're here, Puffy needs to talk to you. I said, well, tell him, come on in. So Puffy came in. He said, you know, Mtume, I want you to, you know, I got this artist named Biggie. And he said, I want to do Juicy Fruit. So I said, cool, this is how we do it. It ain't a long conversation. You get 50 Cent, I get 50 Cent. We did a half, we did a page contract. Mm. Very simple. Yeah. If this is the music and you're the rapper, boom. Then he brought Biggie in and we met. It was just, I mean, I took to him immediately, man. He was a sweetheart. And that's how that started, you know. So, I was honored, man.
So how did the New York undercover scoring come into your life?
That was an urban show about two cops, one black and one Latino, mm-hmm. you know, working in New York and shot in New York, real New York themes. And I thought it would be a very interesting challenge. Right. And Andre Harrell, but more importantly, Dick Wolf, Law and Order and all that, were the executive producers. Dick pretty much was running it. And, you know, I got the gig. It was a little difficult. When I brought the theme, Dick didn't like it because actually he never wanted me. Andre brought me. He wanted his man, right. Mike Post. And I understood that.
Mike Post, yeah. Hill Street Blues.
Yeah, Hill Street Blues. So he said he didn't like it. And I said, okay. And then someone over at Universal Studios television department said, send it over to us. Send us a dat. Or the back, that's when we had dats. And she called me back in about 3 hours and said, oh, Mtume, I just took it to the head of, Universal Studios. He said, he loves this. This is where we want to go. And he said, oh, and by the way, he said, tell Mtume, thank you for Juicy Fruit. So, again, you never know. This guy had to be 80. Right. You don't know who's listening to your music. Right. So, you know, I was able to put a sound on television that hadn't been heard. I think the most progressive sound before that was Miami Vice, mm-hmm. you know.
Now, we're talking mid-90s at this point. The Mtume, the band, has stopped.
Yes.
So why did you stop the band?
It was time. You always got to know what time it is, you know. You always got to know what time it is. And it could have gone on. But then I would have been right back at that point I told you. I never wanted to experience that again, sitting down trying to write some music and you're not doing it from here. Yeah. You know, you're doing it because you have a formula that you know you can still reach X amount of people. And that's not the reason to create music. I never started like that, and I didn't want to finish like that. Everybody in that band went on to have very successful careers, mm-hmm. especially with Tuatha. She's works with everybody. I mean, Stones, I mean, Dave Matthews, Lenny Kravitz, Philip, my keyboard player, is a principal at the school, runs the music department. So everybody went on to do something. So I felt good about that. But to continue doing something artistically and you're lying to yourself, and if you're lying to yourself, you know you're lying. You can never lie to the people that believe in your music.
Now, you did step away a little bit for some time, but then you also mentored and produced some artists in the 90s as well.
Yeah, I did.
A few different people. This is one of them who you did this track with.
D'Angelo.
Okay, so who was that?
D'Angelo, my man.
Now, this was just a one, I guess for, was it a soundtrack or a coverage project?
Yes, it was he called and asked me to produce that track. It was the old Eddie Kendricks track. It was for Get on the Bus.
Okay.
Yeah, right. Get on the Bus soundtrack.
Now, he's mentioned you as a mentor of sorts. Is it from just this experience of working together? Or?
Well, actually, no. And I had forgotten this, and he reminded me. When he was doing his first album, Brown Sugar, I was in the studio next door, and he came over when he found out I was there, and he was having some, you know, some difficulties navigating through some parts. And I actually, you know, did that with him and helped him through. And then there was another time I was in the studio. So it was a couple times. And but before that, I always told him, you know, when we would talk, man, I said, you've got something special. And you just got to keep pushing and keep pushing. And he reminded me of it, yeah. But he's always been like one of the young cats that I've always felt very close to.
What did you tell him that day?
Don't be scared to be you. That's the only thing you can tell any artist. Because mm-hmm. see, you know what? When you say that, there's certain truths that you got to face. Maybe you don't have it. You know, a lot of people are great in the mirror. You know, we all, you know, that's in the mirror. But at the end of the day, you got it or you don't. So if I don't have it, at least I can, look, if I'm going to go down in flames, it's going to be with my own matches. I don't need you to light me, okay? So be you. And if it happens, great. If it don't, you think of something else.
Right. Now, you did step away from music.
Oh,
yeah. Is that fair to say?
Yes, absolutely.
So why?
I didn't feel it. I didn't feel it. And that's a delicate place to be. That doesn't mean that I won't, I mean, look, I might wake up tomorrow and feel it. You know, that thing doesn't leave you. It's more importantly, you leave it. The thing is always there. But you got to surrender something to bring something to that. And what you surrender is there's no room for BS. You got to be committed to that, you know. And I've been, look, the other thing, you know, you and I talked about this. I mean, we sit up here talking, man. We went through damn near 40 years of music, easy. And I played a lot of different types of music. So it's not like most people spent their, pretty much their career in one or two genres. Mm-hmm. I haven't done it all, no such thing. But I was a musician. Then I said I want to be a writer. Then I said I wanted to produce. Then I said I want to put a band together. Then I said I wanted to score. I think for me now, something I would love to do, I would love to do Bonnie Raitt. Something just that would, well, like all of it. It's been here or here. But I'm not really touched by, I appreciate what I hear, but I would need a challenge.
Right. And you return to activism as well.
Yes. The last 20 years, I spent on New York radio on a political talk show called Open Line. I mean, all the politicians came through. I've traveled on several delegations to Cuba, Libya, Sudan, Ghana, South Africa, you know. Pretty much that's the water. That's the shape. So when I say I left music, I actually just started pouring it into some other other things. Mm-hmm. But I think, as you and I were talking earlier, I think right now, the first interview I'd done of any serious consequence was with you and Red Bull, and when my son hooked it up. And this is the second one. I haven't talked about music in 20 years, not like this. And I feel at this age, I got a lot that I can give, you know, just, you know, experiences or you know, how this goes, how that goes. And it's time for me to give that. Because, you know, once you split, that's it. Yeah. He was cool, but he didn't leave us no information. So, you know, like I always joke with people. They say, Methuselah lived to be 900. I said, yeah, well, what else did he do? I mean, so he lived. What did he do? Oh, I don't know that. But I'm glad to be here. And anything that I could do and be of help about you got it. I'm about giving this information to the next generation. That's what it's about.
Mm-hmm. Well, before we open it up to questions, I just wanted to know if you thought there was a, through all the different facets of your career, the different phases, is there a thread that you see that connects them in some way?
If there is any thematic fiber in my career or that one thing you could point to, it goes back to what I said earlier. I never lied to the music, and the music never lied to me. And when you finish with a phase, move on. Move on. And that's the only way you expand the music. And being open. Like, I've never been one of them old heads that was, that ain't nothing, you know, because it's new and you don't understand it. Well, then learn it. Understand. I've never been threatened by something new. That's what I live for. I live to be inspired by something I haven't heard. How else do you grow? That's why we got too many midgets. We got too many midgets in the world right now. They don't want to grow. And, midget music, yeah. Yeah. Always be open to the next thing. I got an 11-year-old granddaughter. She might come up with something next year that I never heard. And you know what? I'm going to be right at the crib. How did you get that sound? Because I come out of jazz. And you have to understand, in jazz, everybody shared. That's the other thing. Everybody shared. I mean, I had a problem once with some rhythms, odd time signatures. I called Max Roach, a master. You don't have that now. I mean, people, these cats hold on like they got the secret to cancer. You understand? Well, how'd you get that cymbal sound? Or what chord did you play? You don't grow the music by doing this. You grow it by that. And if you don't get anything from what I'm telling you, everything I arrived at because somebody showed me something that I could add to it. But you got to share. That's what I love about when we're taking us through those rooms, man. You guys are working together. You're sharing. It can't grow by itself. It grows with expanding the sphere of information. Bam, there it is.
There it is. All right, who has a question for Mr. Mtume? Please wait for the microphone.
Hello. Hey, man, nice to meet you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, man, thank you.
I have a bunch of questions to ask you, of course. Rated X sounded amazing on the speakers. You know, everything sounds incredible. When you were working with Miles, you know, Train obviously passed away in 67. Did he express anything? I mean, you said you had a very close relationship with him. Did he express?
No, I not with Train. With
no, Miles. No, with Miles. Oh, yeah, sorry, yeah, with Miles. Did Miles ever express to you anything about Train?
It's a great question. I'll tell you one story Miles told me when he knew Coltrane had to leave the band. They were playing a gig in Philly. And Miles said, you know, because Miles never stayed on the stage. When he finished his solo, he walked off the stage. He said he thought it was the corniest thing for somebody to solo and stand there. You know, he said he just got off the stage. And he said this was after the Kind of Blue album, and they were playing all blues. And he said he went and sat at the bar and was watching Train. And he said it just kept building and building. And Miles said he sat there, he had a drink, and he said he started crying at the bar. And he said, the reason why he started crying, he said, he's got to go. This band can't contain him anymore. And he cried because he knew Train had to leave. One other quick caveat. Train played one night so long, you know, the cast on the band was like, okay, man. You know, because he was trying to find it. So Miles said, he said, why'd you play so long? Train said, man, I didn't know how to get out of the song. So Miles said, take the horn out of your mouth.
So it was a good train.
Who else has a question? Just wait for the microphone. Thank you. Here we go, over here.
Hi.
Hi, how you doing?
Good. Thank you so much. It's been wonderful. Okay, this is going to be a little bit hard for me because I have to make the connection. Okay. So you were talking about writer's block in the beginning, and it's going to be kind of a couple questions. How old were you when that happened, and were any of your peers experiencing the same thing around the same age, and how did you come out of that? Like, did you ever have writer's block again, or was it this extreme realization for you?
It was a revelation. I had to be 30-something, you know. I don't remember which part in the equation of 30s, but it was somewhere in there. Let me answer the next. Did any of my peers experience it? I've never had that discussion, but I know they have. You know, because if you're in this long enough, you're going to experience that. And if you don't experience it, then that says more about you. You know what I mean? That means you're not trying to go somewhere. You're not challenged by the fact that you're not moving. And you get out of it simply by burning the bridge, starting over. I'm not going to use those chords, you know, or I'm not going to use that band structure. I mean, you got to change something about the environment that you create in, you know. Some people go away, but I always say there's no exit from your mind. I could go somewhere else and write, but that doesn't change the fact that I'm challenged. So that's what I did. And that was that period where I said, you know what? No more production. No more. Let me concentrate on finding a new sound for myself. And that's when I had my greatest revelation musically.
That's cool. Thank you. Sure. The other part is, so Miles Davis, when he played Woodstock, he saw all the other bands like getting more into like funk, or he saw what the audience was reacting to, and he knew he needed to make a change.
That's not true.
That's not true. Okay.
No, that was a quote that Marcellus made. On the Ken Burns documentary. I know where you got it. On the Ken Burns, and I hate it. I love Ken Burns, but I hated it because they used two people.
Wynton Marcellus.
And Stanley Crouch, okay, who were diametrically against what Miles was doing. Wynton a lot less now, but at the time, Stanley Crouch, and as a matter of fact, I debated Stanley Crouch. It's on YouTube, okay, on the subject of Miles and the Electric Period, okay. And I gave him an electric spanking because a lot of that stuff them guys have been saying. And you have to understand Miles' character. Miles wasn't about, you dogging me? That's okay, because I'm going to give you more by responding to it. So he never said anything. But we had those conversations and how he felt. You know, and I knew where you got that, right? But that's not true. Miles was evolving. This is very interesting. Two things always happened when Miles made his musical change. He changed music maybe about four times, not just himself, but the direction of music three or four times. The two things you look at, he changed his woman, and he changed the way he dressed. And I'm not even trying to be funny. If you listen to, you know, Round Midnight and those pieces, Milestone, and then you go to the next period, Miles in the Sky, he's dressing there. And by the time we get the Bitches Brew and On the Corner, it's because he was changing. It had nothing to do with sitting up watching Sly Stone and them and saying, oh, I'm just a trumpet player. I think that's how it was said. No, it was honest. See, again, if you change because you're changing to try to get an audience or that is not real change. That's adaptation. There's a distinction. He didn't adapt, he changed. That's metamorphosis.
And do you know if there was ever any like frustration for him in any of those changes? Or if it just seemed pretty seamless
with
him?
No, I never, and we had hours, I mean thousands of hours of conversation, you know, because I'm like a sponge when I'm around the cats, you know, and I remember, just quickly, I remember we were in Brazil, and the road manager came and got me, knocking on the door. It was 2 in the morning. I said, yeah. Well, he said, man, look, Miles needs you right now. He said, no, just come. I didn't know. So I put on my clothes. I went up. Miles was in the corner crying. I mean, he was actually torn. So I went over to him. I said, Miles, what's happening? And he just looked at me and said, man, all my friends are dead. And that ran through me. I mean, just to hear that. He's in a corner lamenting. He said, you know, Coltrane, Cannonball, you know, Fats Navarra, you know, all the cats, Wynton Kelly, Paul Chambers. And he had survived. And that's what he was, why me? But I'm sorry, I didn't mean to go off, but that's the kind. No, he changed out of the need to change. Not, oh man, I need to get some costumes and plug in. Yeah. No.
Okay, I'm sorry, one more question out of curiosity. You were talking about sitting at the table with like Dizzy Gillespie and stuff. I was wondering if you ever had any experiences with Thelonious Monk, or what was your take on his character?
First time I met Monk, first of all, I think he was the most unique human being I'd ever been around. A lot of people say he was crazy. No, he just was on another sphere. Well, it's the Thelonious sphere. And I think he's one of the true geniuses that we produce. And a lot of people don't know the extent of Monk's musical knowledge. I mean, Monk was in Juilliard, I think, in 41. Do you understand? I mean, so this stuff just doesn't happen. You know what I mean? You know, a Monk grows out of all these, he knew all this music. And then out of that, again, innovation. Mm-hmm. He came up with something. He was the architect for the chord structure in bebop.
Yeah, he's very, very spiritual, seemingly. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, who's next?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I'm fascinated by your interest in Swahili culture.
Yes, sir.
Because last year I was at a music shop and I found the Herbie Hancock record. And I saw all the Swahili names.
Yes, sir.
And I just wanted to know what prompted that.
Well, like I said, I was a member of US organization. That was a cultural nationalist organization. And a lot of times, because I had relationships with these cats, when they come into LA to play, a lot of them would come, you know, over to we would have these sessions on Sunday, you know, discussions on Sunday. So like Sonny Rollins would come through, Yusef, and then Herbie and them came through. But they started coming through every time they were in L.A. And Herbie and I really connected on the cut you played, Kawaida. And we just were tight. And then his band, I got very close to them. So they came one day and just wanted some the names. They came with what they felt their best quality was. And we just sat down and went through it. And they've used it. You know, there's just vibrations, you know.
Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. I hope I'm not boring y'all. I mean, I
feel like not at all.
Some of y'all might need a break, go to sleep or something. I don't know. This old head talking too long. I'm sorry.
Hi, sir.
How are you?
I'm good. Thank you for sharing your truths and your stories with us. My question is in regards to cinema and scoring.
Yes, ma'am.
Basically, like the cinematic, like soundtracks, you know, they got this like super clean quality to them.
I'm sorry, super what?
Clean.
Yes.
And just super quality. And real life is not super quality. And so, like, coming from a jazz background, do you ever think or get frustrated by, like, it being so clean and not think to yourself that maybe, like, we should, if we're pushing for us to do something different, why not, like, make that guy walking down the street sound like that guy walking down the street? Really, like, with the music, just that way, like, that experience, as opposed to just, like, this escapist fantasy of what, like, the viewer thinks of this guy walking down the street.
Right. I think that's an excellent question. For me, and I can only give you, you know, what I feel, like I said, you don't have to be locked into the time zone of the film that you're watching. Musically, you can go anywhere. I'll give you a perfect example. Star Wars. Okay? What is that? Was that future? Or was that old symphonic? Dun, 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 okay? But that worked for some reason. So you'd be surprised at things that you've already digested that are examples of what I'm talking about. But it's not enough of them. It's not enough of them. Between the ones I hate? I hate to see movies that were shot in another century and the music, why are you composing like that? It's also about being, again, that word, open. Music is as virtual as anything. You can put it anywhere if it's right and if it works. That's the key. If it works, it's right. And why not try something?
How about stumbling a couple of times? You stumble a couple of times, you'd be surprised what you stumble on. But I do think there's this worship of exactness that's really a drag. Okay, we worship that. Cats go to school, learn how to play Coltrane solo on giant steps. So what? I can play every note. Okay, that's what he did. What can you play? We start into what I call Mac music. We take these things and we just become carbon copies. Somebody's great because they can play like Sonny Rollins. That's not a reason to be great. You're a drag to me. Because you're just playing copy. You know, it's like, you know, those paintings that you could buy. I don't know if they still have them. You paint by numbers. And when you follow the numbers, you come out with a portrait or something. But you didn't paint it. You follow in numbers. It's copycat. And too much copycat has been able to slide by as legitimate music and legitimate artists. And they're not. They're copycats. But y'all need to say that. The problem is the public that knows is scared to say something. Because then you're dogged. Oh, you player hating. No, I'm not. This shit's not good. It's not good. And y'all need to say more of that because too much is let by because celebrity worship. You gotta just call it out. Because it won't move forward. It's like Mac Music, 5 million served, nobody satisfied.
Cool, thank you so much.
I just had a question about when you stopped doing big arrangements and orchestration, and you were talking about you wanted to go to another place and minimize. When you're doing writing those really minimal riffs, like the bass line in Juicy Fruit or something like that, how much is it a matter of sitting down and working over this riff until it becomes exactly every note is perfect what you want it to be, or is it something where it just comes out the first time, or is it different all the time?
Well, for me, and like I said, everybody's different. That's a great question. Like I said, I went into for me, was like coming from the big orchestration stuff to neo-minimalism. I mean, Juicy Fruit, I think there's only four instruments playing, maybe mm-hmm. five. But, you know, you mix it so it sounds bigger than what's actually there. You know, I mean, you can personify instruments in the mix. But in some ways, it's more challenging.
No, definitely. To
come down, because now the bass line has got to match something. Like, if we took Juicy, the bass line is really not a bass line. It's more of a guitar line. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Bap. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Bang. Do-do-do-do-do. Bap. Do-do-do. You see? And then you got a little nursery rhyme. Di-di-di-di-di-di. Uh-huh. Okay, chords, everything is riding on the inversion of that chord. Uh-huh. If I play a different inversion on those chords, the melody doesn't work.
So it's
very intricate.
So did you spend a lot of time?
Yes.
Did it take a lot of time perfecting each of those riffs?
Yes. I mean, I want to make sure I understand. You take a lot of time.
When you're writing. What's a lot of
time?
I don't know.
No, I'm not trying to be funny. I'm just making sure I'm answering your question. So if I told you I wrote it in one night, is that a lot of time?
No.
But I had been thinking about it for weeks. See what I'm saying? The conceptually, even though I said that I laid that drum pattern down, things really kind of opened up. But uh-huh. I had been working off those chords and that sound. I'd been in there a year.
Uh-huh. But then it consolidated.
Exactly. And there's no reverb on that album. That was the first album I ever did like that.
That's so sick.
Right.
Hey, how are you, sir?
Yes, sir, how are you?
It's a humbling honor to be able to communicate openly with you.
Oh, thank you very much.
I find it perfect that you touched on this whole copycat thing because our good friend Vince Wilburn has made us aware of a band, mostly other people. They've made a verbatim.
That's the name of the band?
Mostly other people do the killing is the name of the band, and they've made a verbatim copy of Kind of Blue.
Oh, no.
You haven't heard about this?
No, sir.
And the Miles Davis estate is vehemently opposing its release and not supporting it at all. But NPR has taken the liberty to showcase it and highlight it.
Now let me make sure I'm clear. They did the record, and everybody's playing all the exact notes and everything?
The drummer, every single thing. Every single thing. To the point where on so the NPR show will play both recordings and swipe between.
And like, that's really cool.
Undiscernible difference.
Oh my goodness.
Between the two. So I just find it very crazy that you had just mentioned that.
Yeah.
And that's what's going on right now. So, and this band is really they really don't understand why people aren't getting it, why people don't dig it.
Well, yeah, why do that? Why do that? Unless you was in, this is in a, we're doing this for Miles, but that's not what Miles would have wanted. I can't even repeat on this mic what I know he would say. Because then what are you doing? What are you doing? And if it's getting to that, that's kind of scary.
I have one other question.
I don't even like the title of the band.
Right. I didn't like it.
I ain't even with that. Yeah, yeah. I don't even have to listen to it. I can't even get past that. Other people, what? Killing what?
My other question is more of a technical question in particular regarding the mix of Juicy Food. You may have been asked this before, especially since it's your first non-reverb record, which is kind of a groundbreaking concept, because we use reverb to hide imperfection, so
yes,
to speak.
Sir.
But when everything drops out in the background vocals, you can lick me anywhere. What?
Everywhere.
Everywhere, excuse me. I'm a little nervous to ask you this question.
Some places I ain't gonna lick.
No. I've been wanting to ask you this question for 20 years. The vocals get apparently louder, almost to the point where you wonder, was that intentional?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
You just solved a mystery.
No, and that's a legitimate question. Because when it drops out, usually you can drop stuff out and then it's there. No, I put that in your face.
Because I would think, okay, maybe there's a limiter there. Okay, you just let you push it.
No, I raised that. Yeah. I want you to hear that.
That's very heavy. I want to commend you for that. Thank you. It's a great pleasure to talk to you.
It's my pleasure.
All right, who else has a question?
You mentioned, it's a little bit convoluted, so bear with me. And thank you for being here as well, I should say, to start.
And my granddaughter loves your shirt, so that's
glad I could be of some service here today. When you're talking about your use of the Lindrum and how it's technology being I feel like this language is crude, but a human extension of your body.
Yes.
And then earlier on, you were talking about the many trips you made to Japan with Miles. That idea in Japan, in traditional art, is very prominent. The idea that technology is an extension of the body. Was that something you're absorbing consciously then, in those trips? Is that something that came through later in your work, or... I mean, is this just a more universal concept for you?
Well, I think it's a combination of both. But you're raising a very interesting question for me. You know, now as I think about and ponder what you're saying, yes, very definitely. You have to understand the context. That clip that you saw, that was played, that was 1972 or 73. You can watch that now, and it makes sense. This was completely off the wall back then. Not for the listeners. The people that would come, they would be like, I never heard anything in my life like that. The critics, this is bullshit. Miles and lost his mind. So we had these two things, but I'm watching a guy play the trumpet through a wah-wah pedal. Do you understand? With that, just that alone, and we're all electrified. All this is happening. My drums were hooked up. I had phase shifters and all. I had the same equipment the guitar players had. So I could go, and all of a sudden you watching me play the gungas, and they sound like something else. We were forging ahead. And I must say, I've never been asked that question, but definitely. But remember that, not just coming to Japan, but you know, that was a working band. We were traveling all over. But the idea that we were all these guys were committed to this sound, you just have to be open. You just got to be like this. And then find out if you got it or not. Again, because that's ultimately, that question will be answered. You can only run but for so long, okay? Then your ego gets tired. Then you got to say, yo, maybe I don't have this, okay? But that's a great question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I ask another question? Were you more, as far as your, like, drumming and your percussion, were you more in the 60s, more on, like, the Elvin Jones side? Or
wow.
Like, what?
Well, you get these people, man. That's a great question. What? That's a great question, because nobody's ever asked me that. I approach the instrument very differently. I don't like conga players, because I feel, again, they are so locked. Boom, boom, bop, boom, boom, bop, all that, you know. So I play, I'm my style, first of all, the cat that I come out of was a great percussionist named Big Black. He used to play with UMass Akela and Dizzy Gillespie. But the people that I played, that I molded my sound after, was Elvin Jones and Tony Williams. So for you to go there, because most conga players don't play I could play in 5/4, 7/4, I can do all that. And play it, approaching it like a trap drummer. You know, being a guy told me once that I was scrambling eggs. He said, but it's the way you scramble them, you know? And Elvin was, you know, and you know, you just play through it. Modernize the instrument, modernize the approach. So, yeah, I molded myself after Elvin and Tony Williams.
Were you into, like, Rashid Ali at all?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I'm telling you, I was avant-garde, man.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
Look, I played gigs with more cats on the stage than was in the audience. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know? I mean, be 4 of us on the stage and 2 people in the audience, you know? But you played to them like it was 2000. No, I really played that stuff. I mean, some of it I don't even believe when I think about it. There's one guy I used to play with named Kylo. For some reason, he was the student unions loved him in L.A., so we used to get all these gigs. He was a trumpet player, but his thing was taking bottles and busting them on stage, and the place would go crazy. Glass flying. I said, what am I doing? Glasses flying all past me. But I was out there, so yeah, I loved all the cats.
Right on. And one more quick question. What was it like for Dave Liebman in the band in the 70s with all you guys? Was he like part of the crew, or was he more kind of like on his own?
Well, he wasn't. You mean on his own?
Were you all like? Yeah. No. Was it like all everyone was cool? You know, was everybody like friends? And
no,
stuff?
No. Dave was a look. I loved his playing. Dave never really bought into that sound, but he fit so well. He enjoyed playing it, just like Keith Jarrett loved it. He just lied about it when he got out of the band, okay? Talking about he was playing, oh, I had to play this electronic. You look at YouTube, look at somebody, he's just smiling. That's another reason I'm glad of YouTube, you know, because he was a liar, okay?
Yeah.
And he was exposed. But Dave played his butt off, and I loved the way, but Dave was still coming more out of the traditional bebop. Yeah. The rhythm section was totally behind trying to fulfill this dream and this vision that Miles had.
That's what I meant. That's why I asked, because you guys were really far out and he had more of a, I guess, per se, a traditional, but he was very chromatic still in his playing.
Oh, man, Dave,
you know?
Boy, he's a bad man.
How did you, sorry to interrupt, so how did you and Al Foster maintain the sonic space? Because he's the drummer, you're the percussionist. Yeah. How'd you not get in each other's way?
Well, when Al first joined the band, when I joined the band, Al was not there. Al came in right after On the Corner. And Miles had a meeting with me and Al. And what Miles did, he switched the roles. He said, you follow Mtume. Mtume, I was the one that was free to play, you know, superimposed tempos. Like sometimes we're in 4, I might play 7 against it. I was totally free. And to what he said, you're my Tony. He was talking about Tony Williams. And if you see, he had me next to him, okay? Because we were playing off of each other. I could have never had that experience playing, you know, this Miles. And he's given the percussionist, you know, basically giving me the direction to take it wherever I wanted it to go. So that's another great question. And I've always appreciated Al, because Al's a hell of a drummer. But Miles was clear, he just wanted the 2 and 4.
right, who's next?
There was a time when Local 802 and 47 were trying to stop drum machines from replacing people. Any comments, any thoughts on that whole era, that whole
stupid time? You don't see, first of all, you don't fight technology, you embrace it. It's like fire. It'll burn you, or you learn how to cook with it. But you can't avoid it. Technology is real. Everything is a combination, as I've always said, of art and technology. So why would you fight reality? Things, look, as we speak, everything is moving. The world is actually moving right now. We don't feel it, but it's on an axis, moving slowly. But everything's in motion. So if you close yourself off to anything, how do you grow? Like I said, she's going to hear something that none of us in this room can imagine. What will the kids 30 years from now hear? Maybe music will just be, and we all go, damn.
So how do we stop these crazy old men with huge funds? How do we stop them from imposing on our creative way of life?
I don't think you have to stop them. Look what you've done here. Look at Red Bull. I don't know, it might be some crazy guys, but look what they put together. See? You know, it's where you're coming from. You know, this to me, this is an extraordinary situation. And I was so happy that this is the man that quells my angst, you know. Because usually I get bored with interviews because they ask you stupid questions, you know. What color socks did you have on yesterday? I mean,
I'm going to cross that one off the list right now.
But again, they can't fight change. And don't let that affect you. Don't let it affect. Are you a musician? What you play?
I'm a multi-instrumentalist.
Okay, what you play?
I play drums, play keys.
Okay, you don't play oboe. I'm just teasing. But no, man. Oh, okay, great. Follow it, man. It's all this. It's all this.
Who else has a question in the back? Can we pass the mic, please?
Hi. Thank you so much for being here. It's like the most insane of work ever. Just like two things. You touched on it really briefly at the beginning, but like the club scene in New York and things. And I was just wondering if like you could share any stories from there. Like Larry Levan was brought up. And were there any DJs that you were looking for? And like how was that whole movement for you? Obviously coming out of like the sort of jazz background and things like that.
Well, I knew Larry. And then you had the tunnel. There was a couple of different places. I was not a club guy. I went out occasionally to get a pulse to what people were listening to. But I was kind of at odds with the club scene because it was just getting, you know, New York had become just so homogenized, man, you know. And it was really affecting R&B, you know. So... again, I wasn't joking about beats per minute and all that. I mean, we were really, it was getting, you know, and that, I hated that bass like doom-da, 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 doom-da. Oh, man, come on, man. And everybody was doing club records. But, you know, Juicy Fruit broke in a club. It broke in, what was the joint up in the Bronx? That was Disco Fever. I remember when we finished the mix, a guy named Scott Folks, who worked at Epic, finished the 12-inch. He called me one night. He said, man, I want to take you to this club. I want you to see the people's response to Juicy Fruit. Because I never thought it was, that's the last thing I thought was people would dance to it. And he said, okay, I'm going to pick you up. I said, well, what time, man, 9 or 10? He said, what? He said, I'm going to pick you up around 3. I said, what do you mean? He said, 3 in the morning. He said, it ain't even really happening until then. And he said, they usually play Juicy Fruit around somewhere between 4 and 5. So, you know, I went with him, and I was just overwhelmed by the response. Because, again, when you're creating something, anybody that tells you they know what a hit is a liar. You don't know. You can only hope that what you felt and you put in that record translates and other people feel the same way. Because if anybody knew that secret, they put it in a bottle and sell it. You just know what you feel good about. But the club scene, I really couldn't comment other than Disco Fever. And that was more hip-hop.
And another thing that, like, just like when we were listening to GC3, it really reminded me of that track by, like, Dr. John that I've been playing, like, Jet Set, that came out, I think, a year later in, like, 1984 on Streetwise. And, like, he obviously came from more of a, like, a blues background. Was he someone that you were, like, familiar with?
Dr. John?
Yeah.
Man, come on, man. Yes. Professor Longhair, Fats Domino, Alan Toussaint, come on now. You got to go to all, you got to go through all those schools. You know what I mean? With your ear. So, man, I'm a nerd when it comes to the music. I don't, it's jazz, funk, R&B, because the more you know, the more you can put in your box, you know? And then when you put your thing on it, you got more to draw from. You just got more, it's more information.
I think when I said familiar, I mean, I obviously knew that you would probably have heard of him. I mean, like, you know, is he someone that, like, because I just trying to, like, piece it together in my head about, like, were you, you sort of followed, like, similar part of that time with the drum machine, like, embracing that kind of, like, technology. Was it something that you were aware of, like, what
well,
he was
no,
doing?
Well, the first time I used a drum machine was actually in 1980 or 81 on an artist that we were doing called Mark Sedain. That was the 808? Yeah, the Roland 808. So I had been messing around. Also, I was also always into the synthesizers, the Fairlight, stuff like that that was coming along. All the polyphonic synthesizers, you know. And if you listen to all my records after, you know, with Juicy on, I've just always been, how do you not deny it? So I've always been, tried to be in tune with that. Technology, always.
Thank you.
My man. Now, y'all know I'm old. I'm going to have to take a nap after this, man.
Well, on the subject of technology, you guys were talking about how you enjoyed Stockhausen's work. And, I have a hard time picturing something further apart than Stockhausen's workshop at the WDR. And you, let's say, Yusuf Lateef playing at the Vanguard. How did you guys actually appreciate it, or what was the environment you would actually consume this music in?
Same environment I would consume Parliament Funkadelic. Same environment I would consume Sam Cooke. Same environment I would consume Modern Jazz Quartet. There is no separation. And that's a great point you're making, because for me, I'm shocked that you would think it would require an environment. It's all one. Like I said, I can tear the roof off the sucker and then put on Stravinsky, you know, Rite of Spring. What's the difference?
Word. On that
yeah,
note.
Yeah, you feel me? What's the difference?
That's
what I'm
saying. Saying it.
There you go.
You also mentioned Parliament. You had some heavy good duty cats on personnel on Juicy Fruit, like Bernie Worrell was playing on there as well. Sax player Gary Bartz.
Gary Bartz.
Mm-hmm. What was the contribution of these people
well,
to the song?
Well, first of all, I played with Gary Bartz in the Into troupe, you know, and I played with Gary for about 5 years on and off. And he's one of my favorite alto saxophones, period. Bernie Worrell and I became very good friends. And I actually started using Bernie when I was on a Stephanie Mills project. So these were not cats that I just called. These were cats that I admired, and I knew what they could bring to what I was trying to accomplish. So those were the connections on those. And I think you should always try to have heavyweights around you.
And you produced Gary Bartz too.
Yeah, I forgot about that. I actually produced what Music Is My Sanctuary, I think. I forgot the name of the album.
Yeah, that was.
Keep Going On, right?
That song
Keep
was
Going
on.
So, if you're trying to work with heavyweight cats like that, is that work for hire, or is everyone having a share in the proceedings?
No, they were never in the band. They were never in the band. The key components in that phase of the Mtume band was Tawatha AG, was our lead singer, myself, keyboardist Philip Field, and bassist Raymond Jackson. I would occasionally use, you know, other cats who were friends of mine and also great musicians.
On the subject of heavyweights, though, for someone that has lived in the era, Smoking Joe or Cassius Clay?
I'm from Philly.
Right, that answers that,
but,
I guess.
You know, of course, I got to give Joe, but Ali, not just because of his boxing prowess, but because of the kind of man he was. And I lived through that period when he was castigated for his position on the Vietnam War, you know, and the three most productive years of his life was taken from him. So we'll never know how great he really would have been. But what he left us is enough to study. But, man, Ali. But Smoking Joe, man, you caused him. I'm having a little confusion, man. Because that's hard. That's hard. He was a great fighter, man.
Thanks. Can we get some COD?
Oh, my God. Can we deliver?
You asked for it.
Now, just think of Igor Stravinsky, okay?
No.
I'm joking. You know, as that was playing, mm-hmm. it's something I wanted to mention also to those of you as songwriters and future producers, find out what your time zone is. And by what I mean by that is, we all write with a specific tempo that we're most comfortable with. My tempo is mid-tempo funk. I mean, I know that. Some people can... a higher tempo or a slower tempo. Try to get in tune with what your tempo is, and that will speed your writing and also improve it and push it forward a great deal, because you don't have to start messing. You know, there's a lot of it you'll leave out, like maybe I'm not a good ballad writer, so maybe I should concentrate on this. Find your internal tempo. That'll be very helpful as a writer and a producer.
Okay, I think it's going to be the last question. Anything else after this, you can come up informally.
Yeah, hey, first of all, thank you so much for this inspirational lecture. I had one question recently. Heard the other day we had a lecture about from Marley Marl, and he was saying about Juicy that he thought it was great that his name was dropped in that song, and that new generation were exposed to him. So I really was wondering what your opinion is, or like your thoughts or view on that song specifically, how new generations get introduced to your music, do you think it's like a good thing, or on the other side that people will only know, like specific generations will only know about your music from that song?
That's a great question. No, I was always just honored, you know, and pleased that another generation was open to anything I created. I don't take my music personally. And I know that might sound strange. I've always been of the opinion the music doesn't come from you, it comes through you.
I feel you.
And just be glad that your antenna is high enough to pick up that signal and you can present that music. Because there's too many great people that I came up under. You know, so that would be ridiculously arrogant. I mean, you know. So no, I'm just grateful that somebody appreciates. If it only sold one copy, I would be thankful for that.
Yeah, I can imagine. Thank you.
We are very grateful that you were able to join us today. So let's all say thank you to Mr. James Mtume.
Thank you.